If I could add one thing. After I gave that answer to the accountant student, and I say this trying to command as much humility as I have, I got a bigger standing ovation than he did. We are all very, very eager to hear you, Cornel, speak. Actually, my secret reason was for coming here is my speaking is just to get me a free ticket to be able to hear Dr. Cornel. The capacity in which he is moving people in this world and making very powerful spiritual changes within this world is phenomenal. And his humility, his spontaneous, natural kindness and friendship toward everyone he meets, it's really beautiful. It's a symptom of a person who really is empowered by God's grace. And Dr. Cornel West.
Yeah, love you, brother. I am
deeply honored to be here with you tonight.
The honor is mine, and the honor is each and every one of us. We are blessed to have you here at Princeton. We're blessed to have you in New Jersey. We need you in the USA. No doubt. But I can tell you this, that my love goes right back at you. Right back at you. Very much so. No, we've had a chance to spend such high quality time these last 2 hours. We broke bread together. We went there to my office and were kind enough to sign my book, and I was blessed enough to sign yours. We talked with my beloved mother. I could just feel the tears in her eyes as she spoke to you and spoke to me and Sister Mary Ann. It was just a magnificent moment. And I want to thank my very dear brother, who I salute, Brother Vinette Chander. Where is he? Yes. We want to thank you, brother. Thank you so very much. Princeton is so blessed to have you and your leadership here. I want to acknowledge, of course, Sister Allegra, who worked so very, very hard. Where is Sister Allegra? Thank you. Some of the other students. And what can we say about Brother Paul Rauschenbusch? We love him so here at Princeton. Even in his move to the Big Apple, he's still a part of the Princeton family, part of the Princeton community, bringing people together in the way in which Brother Chander said. And for me, just to be able to revel in your holiness and your humanity already makes a difference in my life. I do believe that I am who I am because somebody loved me. I'm my mama's child and my daddy's son. Irene and Cliff, Gerald and Idell. That's how we made our entree into the world. And we shall never, ever forget their love. And we shall be shaped by the best of who they are. And that comes through so powerfully in your magnificent autobiography, The Journey Home. Where on the one hand, you're on to what appears to be a foreign country, but it's so familiar to your soul, as you say in that last line of the prologue. And I felt that very, very deeply, indeed. Now, I was born in Tulsa, Oklahoma, so I have a different story. It's not known to being on the cutting edge of cosmopolitan sensibility. And Sacramento, California. But that same love through the West family, Shiloh Baptist Church, Reverend Willie P. Cook and Deacon Hinton and Sarah Ray, my vacation Bible school and Sunday school teacher, they're part of that love that constitutes who I am. And of course, both of us have the deep, deep love for the soul of music. We had long discussions about Otis Redding. Try a little tenderness. And one thing to be said about my dear brother, His Holiness, he is a militant for tenderness. And I always try to be a militant for gentleness and sweetness, because I understand love to be both what, in many ways, is tenderness in private, just as it's justice in public. Those are the two wings of love for me, you see. So justice is what love looks like in public, and tenderness is what love feels like in private. And each time you relate to another human being, and you even more radical than me, I've got to learn much in terms of sentient beings, because I've got to work on that, getting beyond the human. And I understand that not just myself, but many Christians tend to be so centered on the human that we don't acknowledge the suffering that goes on in the animal kingdom beyond we animals who have language. And I attempt to, but it's difficult for me because I've been stuck in a certain kind of human that's problematic, you see. I'm a Jesus-loving blues man in the life of the mind. And you don't hear too many blues songs about sentient beings. Most of them about that girl that got away, you know what I mean? Or that brother who got away. So I've got much to learn in that regard. I'm a Christ-centered jazz man, which means that I do try to take quite seriously the endless quest for unarmed truth, understanding that the condition of truth is to allow suffering to speak. And so I don't even think about trying to be true unless I try to enact and embody a sensitivity, even a hypersensitivity, to the pain, the suffering, the hurts, the wounds, the scars, the bruises of other people. That empathy that you were talking about, that deep compassion that you not only talk about, but you embodied and you connected so beautifully in these last 2 hours with everybody in the room. It's just a beautiful thing to behold. It's the kind of thing I think many of the students there will remember it for the rest of their lives, when you actually see that high quality spiritual presence. And it's such a radical contrast to our culture of superficial spectacle, where everybody tends to be, if not addicted to stimulation and titillation, so deeply shaped by it that we don't even take the time to dig beneath the surface, to get beyond the weapons of mass distraction that culture bombards us with every minute, every day, every month. And then along comes His Holiness with the serenity, the spiritual maturity, the moral integrity, the personal dignity, and says, just bear witness. Be a sermon rather than give one. You see, don't even need to talk about humility, just be humble. You know, a couple of months ago in the States, we had a sustained discourse on civility. And it's just a matter of just, won't you just be civil? I mean, why you got to have this sustained discourse? Just be respectful, that's all. It's like the conclusion of a practical Aristotelian syllogism. It's action. It's not just a proposition. It's not a sentence. It's not a theory. It's a mode of being in the world. It's a way of life to be embodied, enacted. And I did learn much of that in Sacramento, California. There's no doubt about it that in some ways, Brother Paul said, I'm both from the West, Cornel West, but we know that's the name of a slave master. I just picked it up after slavery was over. I don't know what my last name is, but Cornel X might be stretching it, so I held off on that. So I can't claim the West in that regard, you know what I mean? Growing up in California, that's another West. Sunshine, but earth shakes and quakes. But for me, I have been shaped by the legacy of Athens, by Socrates' preoccupation with questioning. The unexamined life is not worth living. That meant much to me when I was living on the chocolate side of Sacramento, going to the bookmobile and reading Plato and Kierkegaard for the first time. I'd read Kierkegaard, put on some more Curtis Mayfield. I'd read Plato and listen to Sly Stone, who actually did play organ in my church, Shiloh Baptist Church, every first Sunday, Northern California Mass Choir. He grew up in Vallejo. Sylvester Stewart, genius that he was. And he could play that organ before he became Sly Stone. Very much so. But also that legacy of Jerusalem. And of course, we want to acknowledge our precious Jewish brothers and sisters. It's Passover tonight, first night, you see. And there is, for me, no Christian faith. There's no Jesus, let alone Christ, Jesus of history and Christ of faith, without that prophetic Judaic tradition that deeply shaped me in a fundamental way. Each and every person has a sanctity, not just a dignity the way the Stoics talked about it, but a sanctity, a value that's priceless. It's actually a value that has no price, no market price. The only way it can be accounted for is either a Christian like myself, religious person, tied to God, deity. But even with our secular brothers and sisters, they have to come up with some standard that gets beyond the everyday culture, the everyday life, the civilization, fleeting empires, changing regimes, to keep track of that sanctity, which is the ground of our equality. So there's a sense in which our secular brothers and sisters are building on our religious capital. Even if they don't have a cognitive commitment to God, their notions of equality somehow have to be anchored in that which cuts across the grain deeper than fleeting cultures and changing nation states and contingent civilizations and empires, you see. Something that gets beyond in some way. And these legacies of Athens and Jerusalem for me have been brought together best in the black cultural expressions, the best of the black cultural expressions that said, in the face of 244 years of white supremacist slavery, that somehow we were going to love our way through that darkness and not succumb to a hatred of the slave master, even as we loathe the barbarity and the bestiality of slavery itself. And that's what those spirituals are about. See, I come from persecuted Christians in the land of religious liberty, because it was against the law for black people to worship God without white supervision. Just like it was against the law for black people to learn how to read and write. You see, they held on to a depth of spirituality rooted in a Jesus, indeed. But there's the Howard Thurmans who embrace the East. There's John Coltrane's Love Supreme and other grand examples of embracing the East. There's Alice Coltrane, the head of the ashram. God bless her soul. She just passed just 2 years ago. But she comes out of that same tradition. How do you look terrorism in the face? 244 years of slavery, 90 years of Jim and Jane Crow, lynching every 2.5 days for 50 years, and still muster the courage to love. Refuse to succumb to revenge and drink from the cup of bitterness. And say, somehow, we're going to hold on to love and justice, not revenge and hatred. We've always known that hatred is the coward's revenge against those who intimidate you. Always cowardly. How do you learn to be courageous? Love wisdom, love justice, love neighbor, and love enemy. And I am that kind of Christian, that I really do try to love my enemy. Now, of course, I don't try to do it on my own at home. It's a little too difficult. I need grace for that. It doesn't make any sense whatsoever of talking about loving your enemy if you don't have some connection to a power greater than you. It's the most absurd thing in the world, given the fact that the world is shot through with hatred, envy, player hating, backstabbing, domination, subjugation. These are the cycles of history that the great Vico talked about. How somehow do you break it, even if you only break it in one life or one community? It's got to be that kind of love you're talking about. That's why I say amen to what you said. Amen, amen. The way Curtis Mayfield would say, amen. No, indeed. But I think the real challenge these days, especially with our wonderful students here at Princeton, is how do we convince them that the aim of life is not to be the smartest person in the room? And then after that, how do we convince them the aim of life is not to be the richest person in the room? It's like this film, Social Network. I almost won an Oscar, you know. I read the New York Times, The Triumph of the Human Spirit. I said, did you see the same film I saw? Smartest person, richest person, and treating women in a manipulative way. You see, what depth of spiritual malnutrition are we talking about? The wasteland. What height of moral constipation are we talking about? But even if they knew what's right, it's just stuck and it won't flow. Morally constipated to the core. And that's the challenge of all of us, but especially young folk, and especially in a place like Princeton. You see, because a place like Princeton is so magnificent, it's wonderful. We just had this powerful concert here just two nights ago, and we saw the seniors stand up, and it was quite moving. And in a place like Princeton, where it's not just a privilege, but it becomes so bubble-like that idolatry can seep in before you even know it. And so you leave thinking you are well-equipped for the job, the status, the stature. Then your mama dies. Catastrophe. Spiritual crisis. What kind of armor do you have in place to deal with an everyday occurrence? We were talking earlier today about, I was at the prison this morning at Wagner. And the brother asked me a question, moved me so deeply. He said, Brother Wes, I'm locked into bad habits and I can't break loose. And I say, Brother, you're not the only one. All of us wrestling with that in some way. He said, oh, not you, not you. I saw you on television. Looked like you got it together. I said, no, no. No, no, no. I told you I'm a Christian. That means I'm a sinner. I'm just a redeemed sinner. Just trying to love my crooked neighbor with my crooked heart. It's the best I'm going to do. He said, it's true that I've been transformed. Early part of the book, I was a gangster. A Robin Hood, though, so I had some tilt toward the poor, but still a gangster. After my transformation, I still have gangster proclivities. To this day, wrestling with it all the time, you see. And that's why to be inspired and instructed by your witness, your book, now in the flesh, for me is it's a spiritual high, because I live in despair. Not every day, but I wrestle with it. It's like the 32nd chapter of Genesis for me. Jacob wrestling at night with the angel of death. He merges with a new name, Wounded Doe, God Wrestler. And a blues man and a jazz person is always a God Wrestler. But I got some questions that I don't fully grasp in terms of the depth of the suffering, but the kind of suffering you're responding to in India, and the kind of suffering you talk about when you come to this country and talk about the hoods and the ghettos and our sisters dealing with patriarchal abuse and the workers not being treated with the dignity that they ought. And you're right about bankers. We need bankers, but we need thoroughly, democratically accountable bankers. Some regulation so that the greed cannot run amok to such a degree that billions are lost at the top, and yet 21% of our precious children of all colors live in poverty. That's the kind of moral indignation that you and I think rightly share. And it's because I think our common ground, which is this fundamental commitment to be faithful unto death, to attempt to live a life of love and compassion to the best of our ability. Very much so. But I want to stop here because we want to save good time for question and answer. And a jazz man has to have call and response. And a soul man has got to have dialogical interaction. Indeed, indeed, indeed.
I would love to hear the kind of, each of these talks could be actually translated into music, wouldn't that have been an awesome concert? So I feel like we've been blessed so much, and we are, we realize that we're almost at 9 o'clock. So we know you have lives, but we're gonna keep going for a little while and ask a few questions that have been submitted by folks. I'm gonna start with something. We've talked a lot about ways that you see one another and the ways that you are relating to what each other is talking about. And what I want to kind of do is try to take a different kind of tack, and maybe you can say what it is that one unique thing that you have found in the tradition that you call your own, that you haven't found somewhere else and that you value so much as precious that you just want to say it tonight for us, so that we can hear that one unique thing that is just beautiful in your tradition, that is also unique to your tradition, that you think that it's important that we hear that tonight. And I have a lot of questions. We're not going to get through them all, so I want to encourage you to be complete, but let's try to answer a few questions. So can either one of you, is that a clear question to each of you, or yeah?
What do you think? What do you think? One of the questions I've always wrestled with is why Socrates never cried and Jesus never laughed. Now, Krishna does dance and laughter, right? I like that. I like that. I like that. Now, of course, Jesus weeps, and that's the central message. He weeps because he loves so. And I think in many ways what I find distinctive about my own understanding of the Christian faith is that it brings together that sanctity of the individual, that rich individuality, so each and every one of us are unique and distinctive and irreproducible. No one like us, made in the likeness of the image of God and so forth. But also that sense of history. A sense of history in which ordinary people, or those Sly Stone called everyday people, are at the center. That they have a depth of complexity which measures that of any king or any pauper. It cuts across, up and down. It's across the board, each and every person. As ordinary as they are, always extraordinary in the eyes of God. So it's that sense of history and sense of individuality that I've always found as a something that speaks to the depths of who I am. And it also has to do with, again, the music, you see, because I think the music that comes out of my own tradition is one that does include a laughter, a comic dimension. The blues is tragic comic. It's tragic comic. It's like a Chekhov play. It's like a Beckett play. You have to laugh to keep from crying, but the despair is overwhelming, but not overwhelming to such a degree that it has the last word. So you can smile. B.B. King said, nobody loves me but my mama, and she might be jiving too. That's the blues. But B.B. does it with such style, with a smile, with such compassion. He's a blues man. He's a Jesus-loving, Mississippi-born blues man too. Genius that he is.
I spoke to his mother today, and she definitely loves you.
Oh, she does. That's true. No doubt about that. No doubt. I love her too, I tell you.
One unique feature that I found in the bhakti tradition of Hinduism, the path of devotion, first of all, I'd like to say I don't see unique as something exclusive of other spiritual paths. I think in the essence, there is a common uniqueness.
Yeah.
And if we realize it in our own, we have the power to see it in others. But Lord Chaitanya, who is an avatar of Krishna, which is the name of God, which means the all-attractive one, he wrote a beautiful verse. Na dhanam na janam na sundarim kavitam va jagadisha kamaye mama janamani janamanishwari bhavatad bhakti rohaita kitvai. It's a prayer to the Lord. I do not want wealth. I do not want companionship with a sexual partner. I do not want power or prestige or followers. I do not even want liberation from suffering. I only want one thing. That in every situation, wherever I am forever, give me the opportunity to serve you, my Lord, as the servant of the servant of your servants. This idea of selfless service, without ego, without an agenda, in whatever particular profession or walk of life we may be in, our perfection is not to do it primarily to get something, but to express the love of God we found in ourself through our actions, through our words, and through our thoughts. In the tradition I follow, there's an understanding of God or the Absolute Truth in a very intimate and personal way. There's a verse in the Srimad Bhagavat, Brahmeti Paramatmeti Bhagavaniti Shabjate, that this one Absolute Truth, or God, has three features: the all-pervading impersonal, the Lord who is seated within everyone's heart, and the supreme, eternal, all-attractive person who reciprocates our love. And to have this experience of an eternal, intimate, loving exchange with that all-attractive person, who's the source of all beauty, all knowledge, all strength, all wealth, all fame, all renunciation, everything beautiful in this world, the Gita says, is only a spark of the splendor of the Lord. And what really attracted me is Krishna. This conception of God really likes music. He's famous for his playing and his dancing as well. And he's inviting us all to join his dance.
A little spiritual break dancing. That's all right with me.
It's soul music.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
I'm just stuck with spiritual breakdancing, but I'm going to move on. How do your traditions address the existence of evil in the world?
I mean, it's even the existence of evil is too abstract a formulation. You know, that it begins with the body, with the somatic. The sound comes out of the lamentations, the moans and groans. It's the evil that is felt as well as the evil coming at you. And so even the existence of evil almost sounds too textbookish rather than lived. And you're always already in the midst. It's like Dante's beginning of the Inferno, right? In the middle, in the midst of it all. That's where we start. Or what Beckett calls the mess. Or what Bootsy Collins calls the funk. We just finished the album with him, be out in a couple of weeks, called The Funk Capital of the World. But that's not an advertisement. That's just a fact I'm just letting y'all know about. But you're in the midst of the suffering, of the misery, and so forth. You see what I mean? And so the question becomes, always already, you're going to have to do something about it because it's always already there. Mm-hmm. It's going to be, what is the quality of the love? What's the depth of your service as you wrestle with it? And it comes in vanilla suburbs among our well-to-do brothers and sisters in terms of psychic death, spiritual emptiness, hollowness, and so forth. Even with all the big material toys and whatever, you still have that evil coming at you in that form. Or you can be in the hood where you have material deprivation, where you don't have the kind of schools and housing and child care and health care that people ought to have. But it comes in psychic as well as material forms, economic forms and so on. So that for me, and I think this is true, anybody who talks concretely about love is always already talking about how we human beings must be armored, as it were, echoes of the sixth chapter of Ephesians for me in the New Testament. How we're armored to deal with these various forms of evil. We had a wonderful discussion, and I know that Reverend Deborah Blanks is here somewhere. We had a wonderful discussion that is at Princeton Seminary with the clergy there, the AME, and it's just an echo of this tradition that I'm talking about. But it's a wonderful question.
Thank you. Thank you. Beautiful. From another perspective, evil's origin is darkness, and good's origin is light. If we turn to the sun, we see light. If we turn our back away from the sun, we see a shadow. In that shadow is darkness. When we turn toward truth, when we turn toward God, we live in light. When we turn away, we're influenced by this shadow, this darkness, ignorance. And today, this dark and light is simultaneously in all of our hearts. One of my dearmost loving friends of life, His Holiness Bhakti Tirtha Swami Maharaj, I would like to share an analogy that he writes in one of his books. Actually, the reason I'm here tonight is because of him. He was born in the ghettos of Cleveland. But by his love for life and his respect for everyone, he came out of that and got a full scholarship to Princeton University. This was in the 1960s. And he was a civil rights leader here. His name was John Favors at that time. And he graduated from Princeton. And gradually, his spiritual calling made him a Swami of the Bhakti tradition. We share the same guru. And how much we had in common. Our hearts. Some years ago, he was in his last stages of melanoma cancer. And I was at his bedside for the last 8 weeks, where we shared our hearts. And one day, he took me by the hand and told me, "I know you have been writing this book about your travels, but you must write this book." I said, "Isn't this an act of arrogance to write a book about me? And if I tell the truth, brother, nobody's going to believe me." He said, "This is not your story. This is the story of how God called a young boy on a journey to seek out the same meaning in life that everyone is looking for. And if your book could help anyone, if it could give hope and meaning to anyone's life, then it is an act of arrogance for you not to write it. Promise me that you will write this book." He was on his deathbed. I promised. I came out of the room and decided, I'm going to talk him out of that promise. But before I could, he passed away. Surrounded by hundreds of loving followers and friends, crying and singing God's names around him. I can speak for hours about the beauty of this man's soul. But he writes that there are two dogs in everyone's heart. There's a good dog and there's a bad dog. There's our divine and evil demoniac nature. Spiritual life is meant to transform arrogance into humility, hate into love, greed into generosity, selfishness into selfless service, vengeance into forgiveness. But these dogs, they're always fighting. And which one howls the loudest? Sometimes this bad dog and the good dog have you ever had that experience? Maybe it's just me. Bhakti Tirtha Swami explained that the dog that will win is the dog that we choose to feed. Mm-hmm. By our moment-to-moment choices we make in life. And when we keep feeding that good dog of goodness, and we refuse to feed that dog of evil within us, then by the power of God's grace, we can be free. We all have to grow old. We all have to get diseased. We all have to die. The highest freedom is freedom from that selfish, egoistic evil. Mm. Freedom to live in the light of God's grace and God's love.
Yeah, that's powerful, 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 brother.
So this will be our last question, and I think it's a wonderful one for people of all ages. It's framed as one for students, but how can one maintain God consciousness at all time, at our studies, with our friendship, at work? How do we maintain, I think, a lot of what we've been talking about tonight, but how do we keep doing this and not only kind of compartmentalize this for great events like tonight and go on and do our other things? So perhaps you can offer some words of wisdom about how to maintain the things that both of you, the wisdom that both of you have been imparting, and how can we take this into our lives?
I think we got to feed that right dog. That's what it is. You got to keep track of the right dog, that's all. And I say that in all seriousness, because in many ways that is an answer to my brother's question in the prison about being locked in the bad habits. You know, how do we learn how to die in order to learn how to live such that we attempt to have that bad dog less powerful? We never fully kill him, but less powerful. And it's a matter of trying to, I think, muster courage. I think one of the challenges of university life is that, as I said before, it puts a premium on smartness, and that's fine. You know, there's nothing wrong with smartness when it's connected to compassion and love, but we don't put a premium on courage. And I think we live in a culture where conformity and complacency and complicity has become such a way of life, where everybody seems to be up for sale. Everything is up for sale. Just a matter of the highest bidder. That's feeding the wrong dog. And the question is, how do you have a courage that says, I'm going to have the kinds of loving habits, and I'm going to hang around people who are trying to cultivate those habits, which puts you over against the grain? The dominant orientation these days is to become well-adjusted to injustice. That's what success is. Just well-adjusted to injustice, but I'm doing fine. Look at me. Look at my foliage. No, we want to know what your fruits are. We don't care about your foliage. By your fruits, you shall know them. Right habits, the right dog, love-centered, compassion-oriented, but courage to love. Right back, John Coltrane's Love Supreme. That's it. Courage and love. Courage and love.
Music to our ears. To our hearts.
To our hearts.
Thank you, Dr. West.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, my brother.
Balance is the crucial consideration for living, as it is said in the Bible, in this world but not of this world. Mm-hmm. The Bhagavad Gita was spoken to a warrior on a battlefield of how to live in perfect, pure, divine consciousness while performing one's duty according to the necessity of the time. The most unlikely place. If we have a strong spiritual foundation, as we were discussing before, we can maintain our ideals, our integrity, and the sacredness of our purpose in life under all circumstances. Whether we have families, whether we're monks, whatever we may be, we have a perfect opportunity to perfect our lives by humbly taking shelter of the Supreme Lord in that situation and striving to be an instrument of the grace of the Lord. Mm-hmm. If a person wants to do studies, or wants to be an athlete and work so hard in what they're doing that they don't give time to eat or sleep, how long will they survive? Eating and sleeping give us strength. So similarly, although we have our domestic duties, our occupational duties, our social duties, we also have our spiritual duties. And they should not be neglected. In this incredible auditorium, Richardson Hall, we're looking at the arches and the pillar and the dome and the woodwork. But how many of us today were thinking, this place has a fabulous foundation. But yet the foundation holds up everything. We have to recognize that we must give time to the spiritual foundation of our life to build everything else we do on this love, this compassion, this hope and this meeting that Dr. West is talking about. And for this, we need to give time to be with the right people, to have our spiritual practices. It's like feeding our spiritual strength.
Yes.
By giving that time, by having a spiritual place in our home, by going to a spiritual place where we can congregate with like-minded people. To actually connect with God, with God's name. And to pray. To pray to be an empowered instrument of something much greater than ourselves. Because, again, I'll refer to the Bible, since I'm with Dr. West, I'm being heavily influenced by him. Lord Jesus said, be hot or cold, but if you're lukewarm, I spit you out. It's required that we have a very strong burning feeling of necessity for our spiritual lives, to have that strong foundation and to balance that with our lives. I remember in 1971, I was living in the bank of the Ganges, and one old man, he was 85 years old, I was living with him. I was only 20. He was a Hindu man. And every day he would take me to his best friend, whose name was Mohammed, who was a Muslim. And we would speak an hour every day about our realizations and our experiences. Muhammad would speak from the Holy Quran. Narayan would speak from the Bhagavad Gita. And I spoke from whatever varieties of things that I knew. And what was incredible about this is it wasn't that they were tolerating each other's differences. They actually really appreciated each other and felt inspired and enlightened by each other, although they were both totally faithful without compromise to their own religion. One day I asked Narayan in private, how is it that in a place like India, where there is so much communal conflict between Islam and Hinduism, that a Muslim and a Christian can be best of friends? I'll never forget his answer. He said to me, a dog will recognize his or her master in whatever way the master dresses. The master may be in a tuxedo, blue jeans and a t-shirt, underpants, or maybe totally naked. But the dog will recognize the master. If we cannot recognize our supreme master, God, when he comes to other people in other times, in another dress, then we have so much to learn from that dog. The cultivation of true spirituality should bring harmony to the world, not division. And it is very important that we cultivate our particular spiritual paths by giving precious time every day, but doing it for the right purpose, to be instruments of love and peace. Thank you.